Welcome everybody to a music industry interview hosted by the Department of Music at Albright College. My name is A.J. Merlino. I'm the Director of Music Industry Studies here at Albright. Today's coverage of the event is hosted by BCTV, who I'd like to thank for covering our event today and tomorrow. Today, we have a very esteemed guest, Troy Wollwage from the Yamaha Corporation. Troy.
Oh, me. Hi.
Yeah.
You can clap. Yeah, awesome. Oh, thank you. Good.
Troy is an executive marketing manager for the Yamaha Corporation with more than 25 years of experience in the field. Today we're going to be talking about his experience within the music industry, with related fields, and a couple of other things, wherever things go. So yeah. Thanks for coming, Troy.
Hey, man. Absolutely. Good to be here. Thanks for coming.
Yeah, thank you guys for coming. Yeah. So, Troy, I know your background, but can you explain some of your background to these students, maybe your educational background and your job experience?
Yeah. So, August will be 14 years at Yamaha. My role, which I've had since I began, I'm the marketing manager for percussion instruments. Any percussionist, anybody who plays drum set, marimba, timpani, all that stuff. Oh, yeah, awesome. So that's I'm responsible for, if you've taken a marketing class, there's the four P's, right? Product, place, price, promotion, and there sometimes is the fifth P called people. So that's basically what I am responsible for. Generally, mostly it's the product development role. So I do all the product development for Yamaha, and then I figure out how much to charge prices for these instruments to our dealers who buy them from us. And I work with all the promotional activities, so everything from print ads to social to online videos to YouTube, whatever it is, all that stuff. And then I work with our sales team in our division to sell those products through our network of 500 or so B&O percussion dealers, B&O meaning band orchestral, across the country. My background is, I graduated high school in, 1987. I'm from Fullerton, California, which, anyone ever been to California? Anyone ever been to Disneyland? So I grew up just kind of north of Disneyland. Lived there most of my life. I'll get to some of that in a second. Went to the University of Southern California. Was really going to go and have a music degree, and I got into school and I don't want to practice. I was not into practicing orchestral percussion or anything. So I transferred, and I have a business degree from USC, and while I was in college, I did the USC Trojan Marching Band, did all that stuff, got to do the Rose Parade and the Rose Bowl and TV shows. I was in Naked Gun. Ever seen Naked Gun? I was in there's a couple other movies and TV shows I did. Doogie Howser, I was in Doogie Howser. Graduated in 91, did not have a job. I wanted to work in entertainment, like movie marketing. Mm-hmm. I wanted to, that was cool to me. There's obviously a ton of studios in Hollywood. It's really tough to break in there, but internship, they don't pay. And it's really, really tough. So I didn't have a job, and I graduated, and I got a phone call from the band director at USC. Said, "Hey, I was hired to put together a band to play in this amusement park in Japan. Are you interested?" And I said, "Oh, I'm not a music major, and I'm not interested." And then he called me back a day later and says, "You got to do this." I'm like, "Okay, hang on a second. So I actually talked to my friends, my family, and they said, "Yeah, go for it." So I went. I was originally going to go for 4 months, stayed a year. I was making $750 a week, not $750 US dollars, not yen. They gave us a room and board, 3,000 yen a day, paid our train ticket to and from the office, which was the theme park. Maybe later I'll explain what this theme park. It was not Disney related, but it was really cool. So I had to work 5 days a week, then 6 days a week. 5 days a week, then 6 days a week. And I had my outfit. I played in two bands. One was like a military band, kind of like, if you've ever been to Disneyland, you see the official Disneyland band. Dun, 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 you know, kind of doing the Ducas and the Gabrielles and all this other stuff. And then I played in this town band, which had singers and dancers and actors. In fact, one of the dancers in that band was this girl, Paige Davis, who has this TV show. She's on the home HLC. She does one of these renovation TV shows. She was a dancer in the group. She was over there. And so I looked like, I had this outfit. I looked like the cover of the Dutch Master Cigar Box. long story. But interesting enough, a lot of the guys that was, one that the tuba player that was in that band is now teaching tuba at Bloomsburg.
Really?
Two of the guys went on to play trumpet with Brian Setzer Orchestra. One of the guys is a bigwig music guy at Disney. One owns another kind of entertainment creative organization. And on, all sorts of stuff. So I did that. Came back in 93, came back home. Lived with my mom again, and I got a job. I wanted to go into advertising. That was my new thing. So I got a job in Santa Monica, West LA, working in a really small ad agency. And I had applied to a bunch of the big ones. There's a ton. At that point in the 80s, late 80s, early 90s, there were a lot of great big ad agencies in LA. So I got a job working at this really small agency. And what was great about that is I got to do everything. I was writing copy. I was placing media. I was going to meetings. We did a lot of healthcare, a lot of hospitality events, accounts. Did that for 3 years. In fact, I'll go back. When I was at SC, I actually interned at a PR firm in LA, which got me some more experience. So I did the ad agency thing, and then I never had aspirations of going to grad school. When I graduated SC, I was like, I am never going back to school. Well, a couple years later, here I am. I went back to grad school. And I got my MBA at Boston University. So I moved back to there. Lived in Cambridge for a year, then lived in Austin for a year. During that time, I interned at Mass General Hospital in marketing. I continued to do that a little bit during the course of the year, my last year. Graduated in 98, came back to LA because I never wanted to live anyplace else for the most part. Got a job working as a project manager, account manager really, with an internet consulting company called Rare Medium. And what we were doing, this was in 98, 99, 2000, we were doing websites for companies, and that's when the internet boom was just taking off. It was a publicly traded company, and everything was going crazy in the internet world. And then I left there after 3 years to take a very similar job with IBM. I wanted to go in the consulting world, so I got a job with IBM, and I loved IBM. I thought I was going to be there forever. 9/11 happened, and I got laid off. In fact, I got laid off September 10th. And then September 11th happens.
Wow.
And, you know, first, for one day, I felt, like, really crappy. And the next day, how can you feel bad when all this other crazy crap's going on? So I took some time off, got married, lived in Manhattan Beach, which is really nice. Went on a honeymoon to Hawaii, came back. I was interviewing like crazy. And I got a job with Yamaha. So how I got this job with Yamaha. So talk about... Here's a good lesson, is who you know, right? So a friend of mine who I've known forever and who used to teach at USC, Jay Wanamaker, you probably heard that name. So he taught at USC, then he left and worked in my role at Yamaha. He moved around and moved over to the Pro Audio Combo Division at Yamaha. I got an email one day from Drum Corps International. Drum Corps, are you guys familiar, DCI, Drum Corps? Okay. So I got an email, there was a banner ad at the bottom of the email about Yamaha. Cool. I clicked on it. Oh, let me check out the job listing, see what's going on. Check it out, and it says Marketing Manager Percussion, Buena Park, California. It's like, wow, that's weird, because I knew Yamaha, the Banner Kessel Division, to be in Grand Rapids, Michigan. So I called up Jay, who had just left Yamaha for Guitar Center, Big Wig Guitar Center. He's like, yeah, they're shutting down Grand Rapids. Only a handful of people are moving to California. You can imagine the cost of living in Michigan versus California, quite different. So he gave me the name and the number of Rick Young, who actually just announced his retirement, who had been there Yamaha 30 years now. I got an interview. I think 2 months later, I got the gig. So here I am 14 years later, doing all kinds of cool stuff, and I get to help people make music. Awesome.
I think it's interesting that you came from a performance background. Actually, I didn't even know that. I didn't know you started as a performance major.
I never took any classes. That's what I was wanting to do. You know, I was in high school, did all the honor bands and the honor orchestras and the ensembles and jazz band. And that's kind of just the way I was going. But then I got to college, like, I don't want to practice.
How did the performance or your desire to perform initially, I guess, influence your future careers or your perspective of playing an instrument influence your industry side of the business?
Sure. Well, it's certainly good question. I think playing an instrument and kind of maybe standing behind the instrument and having that performance aspect to the crowd or, you know, as a USC, here I am on the floor of the Coliseum, and I got the uniform on, I got the sunglasses. It makes you want to perform, right? It gives you, gave me great, what's the word I'm looking for, great confidence to go out and I don't have any problem speaking, as you can tell. I can present in front of anybody. I can do, I have great confidence in my abilities and what I do and what I can't do. I know when to ask for help and when I need support. But it gave me great confidence in my skill sets, and I think that's the bulk of what it gave to me. Mm-hmm. And just broader experience, a greater love for music. I mean, I had no aspirations of getting back into the music industry when I worked at IBM. Mm-hmm. Zero. And this thing just kind of fell in my lap. And that's, talk about a good lesson to learn. There will things that will happen in your life and your career that will just fall into your lap. And sometimes you've got to go, all right, I'm going that direction. See what happens.
What skill set do you think you attained from the performance side and IBM and through Yamaha that you think is really valuable to be in the music industry?
Well, you know, teamwork. Obviously, if you're performing, if you're in a music ensemble, you got to be a team player, right? You're playing, you got to look at the people around you. You got to have a relationship with the conductor, the director. You got to be on good terms with those people. And that's, talk about a metaphor for life, because when you're in an office, whatever kind of setting you're in, you got to look around once in a while and say, okay, we're doing this together, right? We're all in this together. We're all going the same direction. Because if you work in a company or any kind of office environment, you're not all focused on doing this thing together, there's a problem. And that's when companies don't succeed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You seem to have, and I know you have, a diverse skill set because of all these different occupations. So as aspiring music industry professionals, how can they attain all of these different things? I know through internships and other various jobs, being that the music industry is really diverse nowadays, mm-hmm. how can they attain this in a timely fashion?
Well, there's no rush to do it, to get experience. You just need to go out and get experience. I've done a lot of mentoring over my career, and gosh, I even see kids in college and they're stressed about getting a job. Right? Who is not stressing about getting a job? Right? Everyone's trying to figure it out. says the people who already have a job. Right? Right. But once you get a job, you keep looking. There's nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong with keep, because the important thing is to start getting experience at doing something. Right? You don't want these big gaps on your resume when you're not doing anything. Even if you're not working, you're find something else where you can get experience, some other nonprofit experience, or whatever it is, volunteer, do something. That's the big one, yeah.
So who inspires you, or what inspires you to do your job really well?
Who inspires me? Well, I have an 11-year-old son, so he inspires me to be a good dad and be a good guy and do the things that I do. My other parts of my family, inspire me, and I do a lot of genealogy, right? I do all this stuff. So as I have gone back and look at my family history, who came over in some times the 16th, 17th century, they experienced a lot, and they went through a lot of hardships. So I kind of keep that in the back of my mind, like, wow, if they can do that with no electricity, no running water, I can surely do this, right? Other people. Rick Young is a mm-hmm. great example. Roger Eaton, other people at my company who've been mentors to me. The guy who I worked with at the ad agency, who was my boss, and he was the owner of the agency. A great mentor. He gave me a lot of great advice, you know, as I was coming up and whatnot. You know, I don't know if there's any public figure per se. You know, I take things from here and there. And as you go out in your career, you go, you're going to listen to a lot of people, you're going to read a lot of books, right? There may be one or two things you take from AJ in your time here. You know, if you're lucky, I might say something remarkable tonight that you might go, oh, that, I'm going to keep that with me. Your parents might say something. The place where you work, you're going to meet somebody that might say something. You might see something on TV. You might see a TED Talk. All this stuff kind of comes together. And that helps formulate who you are, right? And that helps give you experience in life, and helps formulate, and helps get you thinking about what it is that you might want to do, right?
I really like that you said you were inspired by your family and that you're inspired by colleagues that you worked with mm-hmm. or mentors locally instead of the Steve Jobs or the folks that are the public figures. That it's really important that the students know and everyone knows that you can derive inspiration from your environment and not necessarily having to go to that top tier figure, yeah. or a big public figure.
Right. And not to take anything away from those guys. I mean, there's a ton of people, and that, you know, you mentioned a couple names, and they have the advantage of they're very publicly well known, right? But there are, this world's a big place. There are a lot of people who do their job every day, and they do it well, and they don't require being on social media or being on YouTube or whatever it is, or just being out there. They set a good example for how to be a good person, how to treat people with respect, how to run an organization that's financially sound, how to treat their customers. I mean, those people are everywhere. And if you can find them and pick their brain or even just watch how they do things, man, you're golden.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Let's talk about Yamaha a little bit. You're an executive marketing manager for the Yamaha Corporation. Mm-hmm. How long did it take you to feel comfortable doing your job?
Oh, a couple years. Mm-hmm. Only because I came in to a division that had only six people had moved from Michigan to California to be in this division. So they hired a ton of new marketing people, whole new customer service group, a new admin manager, and a couple other people. And I'm new, mm-hmm. right? I'm the only one with like an advanced degree. I don't know these people. I've got two people on the department that have already been there. One guy that had already been there for maybe 6 or 7 years. Another guy who was an intern that started less than a year earlier. So they're coming, I'm sure they're looking at me like, who's this guy? Why did they hire somebody outside? Like, I could have done the job, right? So it took a while to kind of gain that experience and learn the business, learn the landscape. I didn't know anything really about the music business and how it's structured. I had a great music and percussion background, but I didn't know the nuances of how the structure of the industry really kind of developed and dealing with salespeople on the road and gaining their trust. But that's a huge one. Mm-hmm. So each division, there's a couple different divisions at Yamaha. There's band orchestral, there's pro music, which is basically guitar, drums, bass, and keyboards. There's commercial audio, there's piano, which is acoustic pianos, and then there's a division that does like home audio stuff. And everyone is structured kind of the same, but a little bit different. So most divisions have a sales force of people that are on the road. So we have 13 people that are out on the road doing their thing and meeting with universities and meeting with dealers and meeting with artists and whatnot. So trying to gain their trust, right? So imagine you're a salesperson, you've worked with Yamaha 25 years. Everybody at the home office is practically new. And all the marketing people are practically new. Now you got to go out, you got to make your sales budgets every month, and you got to deal with all these new marketing schmucks who are trying to tell you how they think the business should be done, right? That's a huge one. And a lot of older guys, they've been there a long time, like, you know, that's trying to gain their trust is huge, right?
So Yamaha's a very large, as most of you know, multinational corporation. Mm. What do you think, in your opinion, is Yamaha's purpose within the music industry and then for music education?
Well, you know, ultimately we make instruments. And so we are a subsidiary in the U.S. of Yamaha Corporation of Japan. So kind of like almost every country has a subsidiary, the bigger countries. So there's Yamaha Corporation of America, there's Yamaha Canada, there's Yamaha Music Europe, there's Yamaha UK, there's Yamaha China, and on down. Even Japan has their own separate company just for Japan domestic sales. We are publicly traded in Japan, but everything else we report back to the parent company. Here in the U.S., we are our own separate company. Ask me the question again.
What purpose does Yamaha serve in the greater music industry and then music education?
Okay, so purpose, ultimately, we have a sales number to meet. That's, at the end of the day, you need to make your sales number, your inventory number, and your profit number. Meaning your inventory's got to be no higher than a certain level, and you need to make a certain profit on your instruments. So you put together programs to do that. So, you know, that's the goal. Where our goal is to sell products that serve the needs of the customers in the marketplace. Whether you're a middle school or high school band director, or you're a professional timpanist with the Boston Symphony, or you run live sound for the local studio mm-hmm. or the local event center. So we you know, that's the ultimate goal, is to sell stuff and to accomplish those things. But beyond that, there's definitely much more an altruistic vision of the organization, that's to support people who make music, right? I think what I like to say, at the end of the day, we help, and say you are all musicians or you are using instruments to do something or create music, we provide the tools that you can go out and create. So when I look at that, it's like, wow, that's one of those things that touches you in here, right? So if you can find a job that kind of does that in here for you and helps fulfill that inner workings of who you are and what you're about, great.
Yeah. It's really interesting that way too. In music education, it's great to watch Dave Weckl, right, and Dave Samuels play. But the more inspiring thing is seeing a young musician really get it for the first time. When that spark hits, it's really amazing.
Dave Weckl story. Mm-hmm. So I mean, I go to Japan just about every year, do meetings, whatnot. So at the end of one trip, we're going to the Blue Note in Tokyo, and we go see this band play: Mike Stern, Chris Mindoki, Randy Brecker, and Dave Weckl. And names, anyone, you guys familiar with some of those names? Great jazz fusion legends. And we go through the show, it's like 2 hours of music and whatnot. So after the show, we go backstage. And I mean, there's like 6 or 7 of us from Yamaha. And one of the guys, like, hey, band, just wanted to introduce you to all the Yamaha guys. And we go in the room, and somebody says, hey, Dave, these are the drum set and percussion guys. And he's on his laptop, and he goes, oh, hey. Yeah. That was my Dave Walker.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. So like, he could care less.
Very Dave response.
Less. Yeah. He could care less who I was. Yeah.
So let's talk about technology. We talk about technology a lot in my lectures, on my classes. So how has technology specifically changed your job first?
Oh, I put my phone in there. It is a 24/7 job. And it's not just Yamaha. I mean, it's everywhere. You were expected to be on. They took the phones, the hard phones, they took the hard phones off all of our desks. The phone system is now through my computer. And I can get it on my phone if I want. Awesome, too, right? I can call my desk phone, it goes to my cell phone. Yeah. That's a good one. Yeah, so technology, I am so glad there was no social media when I was in college. I would not be here today. I mean, it's just a lot of that, right? A lot of crazy stuff, because you have to be careful these days, right? If I'm interviewing somebody, if I'm looking at resumes for an intern, we will look you up on social media. Mm-hmm. If I see a picture of you doing a headstand on a keg, you will probably not get an interview. As much as I admire that, I have to decide over one person or another. And so do my human resources people, right? Yeah. So technology is both good and bad. It has allowed everybody to, I mean, you can go online. There's companies who are trying to figure out how much it costs them to make an iPhone. I am lucky people aren't going, how much does it cost them to make a marimba? Or whatever it is, right? If you are a music dealer, that's really tough because now people are going into your store and they're browsing, and then they're going right in front of you. They're looking at the same instrument to see if they can get a better price online. And then they're going to you and says, can I buy this here for this price? Right, so that's when the dealer or wherever you are has to think about what other types of added value services that can you offer that the online dealer can't. It's a huge issue amongst the dealer community. We talked about NAMM, the National Association of Music Merchants, that organization. It's a huge issue. How do you deal and manage customers? Because you all do it. You go into a store and you price check what you're going to get, whatever it is, whether you're at Walmart or Target. I mean, you're checking, who checks prices at Walmart? It's already the lowest price. You're not going to get any lower than that.
Can you explain a little bit added value services and what specific services some retailers use to attract those customers over the online shopping?
Yeah. You know, there's a number of them. One is the in-store experience. You walk into a store, does it smell nice? Do people greet you? Are they dressed nicely? Do they have a branded shirt with their name on it or the company name on it? Do they have a nice display on the walls? Can you see the prices clearly? Do they have a wide selection? You know, all these things that you may not think about, they're very important and it takes time. Merchandising, learning how to merchandise is huge. There are consultants in this industry who make a ton of money helping music stores figure out their merchandising. That's a big thing. Trying to figure out, next question. Something will come to me in a second.
Well, I think it's interesting coming from, again, a musical background, yeah, and a performance background, the attention to detail that you need to perform an instrument, not only playing the right notes and not right rhythm, yeah, but playing tune and playing with everybody else.
Yeah.
That attention of detail really translates well in the music industry, especially with the value added, yeah, right?
Because go ahead. So another added value thing that just popped into my head was lessons. Music stores generally don't make a ton of money off of selling instruments. They make their money on lessons and renting instruments. Renting trumpets, trombones, clarinets, flutes, all that stuff to beginning band students, right? And so why is that? Well, if many of you played an instrument, started out in fourth or fifth grade, right? Mom or dad probably wasn't too excited about buying a $3,000 saxophone, right? Not high on their list. But if they could rent one for 50 bucks a month, whatever that was, now that's exciting, mm-hmm, right? And then they can see, well, if Johnny or Sally are gonna stay with it for a year, then they can decide whether they can maybe buy that instrument or whatnot. So that's where a lot of the dealers make their money. They also, you know, you're starting off and you're playing saxophone, you've got a great student model. Well, next year, the band director comes and they go, Mr. Smith, your son is doing fabulous, but he's, you know, that saxophone that he's got, he just can't, it's a student instrument. If he really wants to audition for the Honors Jazz Band and the Honors Orchestra next year, but he's going to need a better instrument. So that's where the dealer comes, the director will go, he really should have, go to the music store and look up one of these instruments. That's what they call it, a step-up instrument, right? So they move from the intermediate or the beginning level to the intermediate instrument, right? And then if you're in high school and you want to go on and study music as a performance major in college, well, then you got to get a pro instrument, right? If you're going to be you want your ultimate goal is to play for a symphony or you want to teach, right? And then if you're a sax major, then you probably got to have a couple different saxophones plus a clarinet, right? If you're a percussion major, forget about it, man. There's no way you're going to be able to buy all the stuff that you need, right? And so that's where the added value comes in for the dealers, being able to be that trusted resource for mom and dad and for little Jimmy or Bobby or Sally or Sue that can go in and take lessons. So you've got someone in there who's giving lessons who's nice, they smell good, you know, they're not a creeper, you know, whatever it is. And well, that's important. You're a parent, mm-hmm, you're sending your kid into some place to take lessons. You want to make sure that individual is a good person and mm-hmm, they're teaching and they're treating your child with respect. That's all a big part of it. And if you're not doing that, then that reflects badly on the music dealer, mm-hmm, right?
Yeah. Let's talk about technology in the industry as a whole with the age of piracy and just everyone sharing music. It really changed where the money is and where artists need to find their next job, right? And what jobs are available within the industry. Can you comment on how technology has changed the industry as a whole as far as the entrepreneurship or the performance aspect?
Sure.
Goes?
I don't see it too much in my gig because I'm not involved too much with the music stuff, but where I hear about it is from, you know, guys like you and other young people, or not even young people, anybody who's out there playing professionally or trying to make a go of it professionally. I'll tell you what I do see, because I see it in my world of percussion, is that, you know, we're training all these people to be percussion performance majors or to teach percussion, and, you know, they go and they get their master's degree and maybe a doctoral degree. They all want to teach percussion at a university. Well, as you know,
yep,
that's what you probably wanted to do, right? Those jobs don't come up too often, right? Either someone's got to not get tenure, get out of it altogether, or, you know, unfortunately they passed, or some reason. There's not a ton of places, a couple hundred teaching percussion in the United States, mm-hmm, plus maybe an adjunct role if you're lucky, if you know, a place like Central Florida where you got a couple percussion positions. So it's tough. So what we're doing, but what I see a lot of those people come out and they realize, man, I wish somebody would have told me there's not a job teaching percussion. So what they're doing is they're going out and creating their own ensembles. Mm-hmm. You see a lot of these, I don't want to say new age, but new music ensembles are creating their own festivals. they're creating, you know, it's given a whole bunch of life to guys like Steven Schick, mm-hmm. you know, and other people who are arranging this really eclectic percussion music, or just any kind of music for that matter. And they're creating new places, they're holding new events, or they've developed new venues, they're playing out in the community. So I'm seeing a lot of stuff, people who are creating their own opportunities to play, and not so much worrying about recording and writing music, but they're doing a lot of that stuff. I mean, the whole recording, writing music stuff is crazy, and the ideal in the world of mostly, you know, a lot of high school marching band stuff. So the whole world of, you know, when you would go to a band competition, and then if you could go out and go to the table out back after you're done and buy the DVD of your performance, right? You can't do that anymore. So DCI, WGI, Music for All, U.S. bands, all these marching arts activities, they don't sell the DVDs anymore because the rights are too expensive for all the music, and the rigmarole that all the schools have to jump through in order to get the rights to the music that they played is one thing, but they're able to get the rights to be able to put it onto a DVD so it's recorded, and being able to buy that, that's a whole other level of complexity. And so you have, they don't sell the DVDs anymore. Mm-hmm. So the only way to do it is, what's happening now is you have companies who are developing online streaming services so that, and there's one called Flow Marching is what they call it. So you can go online and get a subscription and watch all these marching band and drum corps events. You can watch it live. Mm-hmm. You can have big viewing parties at your home. You just can't record it or do any of this other stuff. So it's created a lot of weird stuff going on. And now what happens, privacy issues is another one, right? So what happens if you're recording an event, I mean, and you stream it online or you put it up on YouTube, but did you get permission from all the performers? Doesn't matter if they're 18 years old or 40 years old. You still need to get their permission to put mm-hmm. their recording up online. And then deal with the fact that, what if there's kids under the age of 18? You have to get their parents' permission before you put their image or likeness online. That's a whole nother, talk about legal mm-hmm. activities. Go be a lawyer. Because that's where that's where a lot of the money is, trying to meander through all this paperwork of who's responsible and who gets paid and who has the rights and who's underage and who's over. And that's a huge, I'm glad I'm not involved with that every day, because that would not be fun for me. Yeah.
So you mentioned law. What areas of the industry, maybe besides law, show the most growth, do you think, in the future?
Well, I wouldn't, let's see. There'll always be music dealers. I mean, there's always a place needed for people to go in and try an instrument, right? An instrument is a very personal thing. Mm-hmm. Because you're playing it with your fingers or your feet. You're putting things in your mouth to play. That's a very personal instrument. You can't just buy, you know, you can. But it's not as easy just to buy something online and put it in your mouth and expect it to be what you want. Mm-hmm. Some people can do that. I think a lot of people need to try those things out. They need to feel how it fits on their body, right? And how it fits in their mouth and how their embouchure works and all that other stuff. There's still a role for all that.
Amazon Prime, a 5-octave marimba.
Somebody, yeah, I guess, sure. I mean, if somebody wants to do that, cool, but...
You're right. It is a very personal thing. Yeah. Part of an identity behind an instrument is the instrument that you use, and that's why it's important to have associations with different corporations and mm-hmm. have a preference in the instrument, because when you play, your personality needs to shine.
Right.
You need an instrument to speak the voice that you want to speak, right?
So you talk about trends, I mean, other, you know, social media, of course, having someone who's... Having a good videographer is great. Someone who knows the law is a good thing. Someone who knows the ins and outs. Artist management is always a huge thing, especially when you're booking. You know, I was talking to someone the other day, and they were involved with booking an event, and the discussion never really came up about how much this person was getting paid to play, or what they were going to do with the content after it was recorded. Well, it's like those are. You should know. You should ask those questions. What happens to the content? What happens to that? What happens to the video recorded of that band in the jazz club that you did, and you asked them if they could record it, and they said, okay, but did they give their permission? Do you have it in writing? That's a big one. Do you have it in writing? So a lot of those skill sets, you know, I would to maybe go a little bit different direction from mm-hmm. your question, but talk about skills you need to have. Finance is huge. don't know if you teach any finance
different
classes.
Different area.
If you can, and I'll tell you, I'll give you an example, because if you're, and it's not just related to maybe product marketing, but event marketing, right? Mm-hmm. You want to pitch an event, you got an idea, or you got a product that you're trying to sell. Maybe it's me. I'm trying to pitch a new product for Yamaha that I'm working on. If I'm going to get somebody to sign off on that product, I better have a very clear idea of how much money I'm going to make and how much it's going to take me to make that product. Because why would Yamaha introduce a product they're not going to make any money on? It's a losing proposition, right? Mm-hmm. If you have an idea for a blues festival or an event, or maybe you want to hold a music event in here, what's that going to cost? Can you put a good spreadsheet together? What are all the costs involved? And how much revenue are you bringing in? What's it going to cost? What are your fixed costs? What are your variable costs? What's your break-even point? How many people, how many seats, you have an event in here, how many seats need to fill at $30 a ticket in order to make money? Those are good. That's a great skill to have, because you can come with somebody and go, hey, I got this idea. Here's my proposal. Got it all laid out. It's nice and clear. You're going to, if someone's got $3,000 and looking to give somebody a grant, and you've got everything laid out of what it takes to make it happen, and someone just has a one-page thing with an idea, you're going to get the money. Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
So a lot of what you do deals with consumers. How do you think the consumers of this generation have changed and have changed the industry?
Mm. You know, I don't...
Or is there change?
Yeah, it's funny. Every older generation, back in my day, it was something, you know. The more it stays the same. Consumers are still consumers. Everyone has a need or a want. Companies at their ultimate goal is to fulfill those needs and wants of the consumers. Sometimes it just takes a little bit longer to get there, depending on what it is that you're trying to. Right, you can, use an example. You can make the best marching drum in the world that sounds friggin' awesome. But if it's too heavy and the kid can't carry it, it doesn't matter, mm-hmm. right? So yeah, it's a big part of it.
It's my last question that I want to open up for everyone else.
That's it?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, if you were to look 10 years in the future and look at the music industry through your Troy crystal ball, what would you see?
Wow. Well, first of all, I will tell you, there is no crystal ball. There's no way to tell. I mean, at Yamaha, we only look 3 years in advance. You start looking out in the future for sales projections, you can't, right? Nobody plans for the downtimes. Everybody wants to plan for great sales and a big economy and peace, love, and happiness. Well, I'm here to tell you, it doesn't always happen, right? 10 years from now, I don't think things are going to change that much. I mean, you have maybe, over the course of time, the big things that have changed the music industry, one is the rise of electronic instruments. Roland's come out with all this great stuff. In back in the day, Korg and Yamaha had the DX7 keyboard. You know, all this great technology, and that will always be a big change and drive change in the industry. The world of buying online has changed the industry dramatically, and that still will keep changing the industry. This industry is huge, huge. And we were talking about the NAMM show earlier. There are so many businesses. I mean, go beyond the big companies in the music industry, and there are a gazillion mom and pop small businesses that are making some cable or some cord, or they're specializing in making some guitar that's targeted towards the heavy metal goth market, you know, whatever it is, and it's handcrafted out of this wood that's been in the lake for 300 years. It's amazing. And it's not just that. I mean, there's mandolins and banjo. I mean, and the number of reeds and mouthpieces and string. I mean, it goes on for days. And the fact that there's companies in other parts of the world making stuff, wanting to sell stuff into the United States, and in the genre, I mean, you know, the genre of music, I mean, that will change. I mean, look how it's changed. I mean, I don't know if you have a music history class mm-hmm. or any type of stuff, but, you know, the genres of music will change, and that will help decide the types of instruments that we'll use and types of needs for the young people coming into the industry. But you know, the other things that the basics that are required of people in the industry don't change, right? Still got to be a nice person. You still got to have a good set of skills of things I just mentioned. You got to have a willingness to make it happen, right? If you're a young person coming in, man, the thing that I look for in an intern is, man, just make it happen. Go out, I'm going to give you this thing. Do it. If you have questions, come back and ask me. But I want to see that you have some forthright to kind of figure it out. Mm-hmm. That's what I want to see. It's who knows? Who knows? Nobody knows where they're going to be. I didn't know where I was going to be. I don't know where I'm going to be. I know I'm going to be tomorrow, but but 10 years ago, 14 years ago, I didn't know I was going to be here. Things just happen, and you got to kind of go with it. I forget what the movie was, but I think it was a line, and you just kind of lean into it. You talk about a baseball player; you got to lean into it once in a while. You got to go after it. You gotta have that thing where, and it's like confidence. You gotta have that confidence. You will get fired. You will get laid off. You will go through a downsizing in the company that you work for. You will have somebody next to you that you sit with in the office, and they're gonna get divorced. Somebody in the floor down below, their mom's gonna die. You're gonna go through all these range of emotions and things in your career. How do you deal with that, right? That's the big thing. You gotta pick yourself up and get through it, because that's life, right? And if you don't deal with it, then it's gonna eat you away. And part of it is you gotta find something that you really have passion for. I'm lucky. I'm really lucky that I found something and I like to do. My son's really proud of what I do because I get to take him to some stuff once in a while. And he's like, wow, this is really cool. That makes me feel good. So if you can find that thing, and it may take a while. It may take you 30 years. You may find it tomorrow. But keep searching for that thing. Don't ever give up. Yeah.
What questions do you all have? Yeah, Kylie.
I know in this last question here, you talked about like certain skill sets that we should all have going forth into the industry and how we don't really know where the industry is all going to be. Are there certain things we can do now as students to kind of diversify ourselves and like prepare for that unknown?
Well, I mean, you know, you can go to Yamaha, look at the job descriptions, right? The very basic skill sets out there, right? You need to be responsible. You need to have good project management skills. You need to be a team player. You need to be a leader. You need to set an example. These are kind of just basic life skills. And in some respects, those are more important. Because once you're in the industry and you might get a rap for being that guy who's hard, or that girl who's hard to work with, you don't want that. Because that will not get you promoted. And that will just eat at you because you think, why is this person getting promoted? And I should be that, you know, don't worry about what you should or shouldn't do or shouldn't be going in an organization. Just worry about doing the best job you can every day. You know, I mentioned that, you know, skills like finance, and which is a huge one, but, you know, strong marketing skills, knowing what the product mix is. And so, you know, sometimes you might be a specialist in direct mail. You might be a specialized in social media. You might specialize in packaging, right? Whatever it is, and that's cool. Go with that and develop those skills. But at the end of the day, man, you gotta be a good person and team player, because when we interview people, whether it's an intern or someone for the team, you know, we're doing references, we're checking with people, and we're gonna ask you questions. Tell me about a time that things didn't go well. What did you do? How did you overcome that? Tell me about a time that you had someone in your group who wasn't cutting it. What did you do? You know, I want to know how you handle the bad times. Because those are the times that brings out all these other things and people that you may not see if things are going good. Things are going good, everybody's happy, it's all cool. But when things aren't going so good, that's when, you know, kind of true colors come out. And if you can be a rock star, so to speak, when things aren't so good, now you're valuable. Yeah.
Other questions? That was great.
Do you think your experience as a performer has given you the discipline and motivation to succeed in the music industry?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, anybody who, you know, you can go online and look at articles about why kids in high school band are great leaders, right? And you have to get up early, got to be on time, got to work with other people in your ensemble. You got to have respect for your leader. You got to fundraise. You know, you got to travel. Absolutely, those things have developed my skill sets. I'll tell you, I was the other morning with my associate, and the other morning I slept in late because I'm from California, and it was a bad night because I was change of times and everything. But it reminded me, because I am a stickler for showing up early and showing up and never being late. And you know where that came from? So I was a freshman in college, and I was with the marching band, and we were going to get on the bus to go down to San Diego to the halftime show for the Super Bowl. It was the Denver Broncos and the Redskins, 88. And I overslept. And I'm running out of the dorm, and hopefully I have everything, my uniform and all sort of stuff. And I'm running out of the dorm, like, oh, I hope the buses haven't left. And I'm running across campus, all of a sudden I see the buses. Aww. And they come down the street. I'm like, stop. And they get on the bus, and the director's right there, and he gives me my per diem. And it was the drum bus, too. Oh, my gosh. and I go to the bus, and everyone's just, like, giving me a hard time. And I'm just hopefully, but you know what? That ingrained in me never to be late again until 2 days ago. Right. Yeah, maybe it's my age. I was just too tired. But it's absolutely your experience that you have performing or being an ensemble, you know, setting the stage, be early. You know, if you're on time, you're late. What's that? That's the right point, right?
Yeah.
Setting up the stage, putting things away neatly. You know, I can tell you how many times I go into a band room or a percussion studio. And it's a mess. That's a clear indication of what's going on in that studio, right? Mm-hmm. So absolutely it's helped. Yeah.
Other questions? Yeah.
You previously discussed your performance opportunities and experience. You got to travel, you got to play music, and you were making some decent money, something that I reckon a large portion of people in this room would sell just about anything to be able to do.
It was only for a year. It was a lot of fun, I'll tell you that much. I don't know. It was never part of what I wanted to do. I got the gig. I was 22 at the time. It was a while ago. I just never felt like I wanted to do that. I had no aspirations at all. It was a great experience. I did that. It wasn't on my bucket list or anything. It was just like, all right, I did this. Cool. Now I really wanted to get into advertising, because I knew I wasn't, I wasn't a great sight reader, and I wasn't a great mallet player, but it was just a lot of fun. But I knew it didn't really, what I wanted to do. I don't know if it didn't really answer your question. Just, it wasn't something that I really wanted to, I didn't want to perform. It was just wasn't what I wanted to do.
We have time for one more. Ooh. Yes. Randy, let's go with Randy.
My greatest, and what was the second question?
And what did you learn from it?
What did I learn? My greatest experience. Wow. Well, I have a lot of great, I am lucky. I have a lot of great experiences. And maybe not even great, I just have a lot of things I get to see and do and hear and watch, right? I get to see a lot of cool music. I get to meet some idols. My first PASIC, I got to meet the drummer for Cheap Trick. Ah, it was awesome. Buddy Carlos. Because I had grew up listening to the Cheap Trick at Budokan. Mm-hmm. I think I have the vinyl at home. It's like, wow, that was great. And we got to meet, Dave Weckl aside, I got to meet some other really cool drummers. I got to see Snarky Puppy with the National Symphony Orchestra a couple weeks ago. I was like, well, that was cool. And I just got to be involved in, I love college football. So I get to go to like a 3 or 4 college football games a year, all around the country, and that's always a blast. So what I've learned from those things, you know, additionally, you know, I've also been in, you know, we've launched a lot of products at Yamaha, And those are wonderful things. I've had three people in my department that have gone on to become sales managers in our company. That makes me very proud. I've had 25 interns that have come through my department. That makes me very proud because a lot of them are, well, aside from some of the ladies who are now having children, which makes me very old, a lot of these people are they're good people. They're teaching music. They're working in a totally different industry, whatever it is. That makes me very proud. But I got, maybe a year ago, I was in Texas, and I was just visiting a school with our sales manager. And we went into this classroom, and they had all Yamaha cornets. And might have been a middle school, 8th grade, 7th grade. And they were all taking their first note ever on a cornet. So here you have 50 kids in a class, never played a lick of anything in their life, and they're going to start blowing into these things. And, you know, aside from what it sounded like, it was like, that was a cool experience. These kids, this is the start of their musical journey, right? That was cool to me. And that's the other thing, is I get to help people, whether it's you or Dave Samuels or Dennis DeLucia or whoever it is, I get to help them continue their musical journey. That's really cool. That's what I like. I don't seek the spotlight or anything like that. You know, that's somebody else's job. But we can take more questions if you want. Unless you got that turns off in a certain time. I don't know.
We have one more.
Okay, whatever.
One more. Yeah.
Otherwise,
one more.
I can hang out if you have more questions.
Yeah. Let's.
This guy over here.
Yeah, he really wanted it.
Yeah.
I was curious about your experiences and the skills you've acquired in the field of marketing that you would like to share.
Marketing has been kind of the basis of my career, because I was a business undergrad. I was a business admin major with an emphasis on marketing. So I got to, you know, I was in charge of the Advertising Federation. I got to organize these events and speakers, and got to get a lot of practice had a lot of classes in just product development and learning, you know, public speaking and all this sort of stuff. So, I mean, and then I worked for the ad agency, which was great. The marketing experience has helped me immensely, because today, and Ian back there, one of my guys who used to be on my team, you know, what I've always told the guys and girls that have been on my team is, what you don't plan for is what you get. And I firmly believe that. We do, there's a bunch of things we do every year. And I'm thinking about like shows and events. So we go to the NAMM show, we go to PASIC, we go to TMEA. As a corporation, we have a large presence at these events. And it's kind of the same thing we do every year. We're involved with Drum Corps, Indoor WGI, Music for All. And it's like, if we kind of do the same thing every year. If we don't get better every year, and just the way we operate and manage our shows and events, we're doing something wrong, right? You need to learn from those experiences. Okay, last year we had a huge problem sending stuff in because there was no loading dock and there was no union labor or anybody to help unload. So next year, right? So now we know. Next year we got to get that thing figured out, right? Or we have a series of ads we need to get done for Music for All. We can't do it at the last minute. So this year we're going to plan ahead. So In my background, I was kind of ingrained early on at the ad agency to write your plan. Write a marketing plan. What is the goal? And that's to this day, we'll be in a meeting and like, stop. Why are we here? What is the goal? We need to deliver this thing at this point, at this time. We need to introduce this product to the marketplace and achieve X number of sales. Okay. What is the goal? Because meetings go on for days, and it's ridiculous. And I can't stand meetings where nothing gets accomplished. But always getting back to, and my marketing has ingrained with me, what is the goal? Write that up in a plan so everybody knows what the goals are, what the objectives are, what strategies you're going to use, and what are the tactics you are going to implement to accomplish those goals. If everybody on the team is not on the same page and has signed off that they're going to do those things, you have a problem. The other thing is, when that thing, whatever you're doing, is over, And you look back, and so you can say, do we accomplish our goals? Did we do everything we said we were going to do? Okay. If great, we did. If not, why? Because, you know, what's the definition of insanity, doing the same thing over and over again and not making any changes? I can't stand doing the same thing over and over again and not doing it better. I want to do it better. I want to save some money. I want that, because that looks good in our department. If we can, if our expenses are lower from one year to the next for doing something a little bit better, awesome. That means we saved the company some money. That looks good. So to answer your question, it's the writing and planning of your marketing document that says what is it you're going to do and how you're going to do it, and so that everybody's on the same page to accomplish those goals and objectives. And if not everybody's on the same page, you as a leader need to get everybody on the same page, and you need to help them understand why it is that we're doing this. But you've got that written document that's been signed off that says X, Y, or Z. Good question.
We have to wrap up. Thank you so much, Troy, for being
Absolutely.
Here. It's been great. Thank you. Thank you, Yamaha, for providing this experience, and thank you all for being here. I hope to see you all tomorrow from 10 to 4 at the Music Business Forum.